Hey everybody, it is Monday, March 21st, 2016, and we are bringing you another episode of Three Men in Anime. This is Peter Bowman, and as always, I'm joined by my co-hosts, Eric Carlson. Say hi, Eric.
Hello, humans.
And Gav.
Hello.
How you guys doing?
I'm doing all right.
I'm not too bad. Yeah.
Excellent, excellent.
Gav continues to exist.
Yeah, just about. I've got a short week at work this week. I only do 3 days because we've got the Easter bank holiday.
Oh, nice.
I get Friday through Tuesday off next week.
Oh, very nice.
Fuck you, yes. Europe, and your fair labor practices.
Oh, boy. So.
All that paid holiday.
Yeah. So, this time we're covering Maho Shojo Madoka Magica, which was Eric's favorite recommendation.
It is the best anime.
As you can tell from what Eric is saying, you can probably guess what his recommendation is, his opinion on the show is going to be at the end. So, Eric, why don't you talk a little bit about the show? Okay, before we start, I'm going to say this. This show is not what one would expect from what you see going into it.
It's one giant big bat. It's great.
Yes, this is the most misleading anime I have ever seen. I was not prepared. I was cringing, expecting one thing. By the end of it, I was cringing because of, oh my god.
So, because of that, if you haven't watched it, I'm going to say this. My actual opinion of the show, I'm not going to say what I think about it, but I will say it is definitively something that should be watched.
Yes.
And if you haven't, I think it's going to be hard to avoid spoilers as we're going through this.
Yeah.
It's a short show. It's 12 episodes. Go watch it, then come back and listen to it.
Do it now and then come back, because it's great. Just get through the first 3 episodes. So here's the thing with Madoka Magica. Madoka Magica is a magical girl show. In the same vein that, say, Watchmen or The Dark Knight Returns are superhero comic books.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Yep.
It basically takes the idea of your average magical girl show, which is, yay, power, friendship, we can defeat random monster of the week, and takes it in another direction.
Yep. I would say that's pretty accurate.
It's a deconstruction. I'm just going to put that out there.
Yep.
Let's cover the characters, because all 5, 6 are the ones that count.
Yeah, there are 6 major characters, and yeah, we'll cover those. We'll get that out of the way first. So, Eric, the big one is, of course, Madoka, right?
Yeah, we'll talk about the titular character. Madoka is, you've got the 5 girls who are all in middle school. Middle school, I think, is they actually state that. Madoka is kind of the... Madoka's a sort of the your typical happy schoolgirl. She's not particularly good at anything, but she doesn't suck at anything either. She's got a little bit of a self-esteem issue, but that's pretty much her only real big flaw. Her best friend is Sayaka, the blue-haired girl in the title there. And she's much more like the tomboy, gung-ho kind of thing. Much more complicated than that. But this applies to all of them.
It's also kind of implied that Madoka lives a fairly easy life because, I mean, her fucking bathroom is the Fortress of Solitude.
Yeah, everyone is well off, upper middle class, mostly.
Yeah.
Mami, the blonde there, is the veteran magical girl and the true believer in the cause. And she very much takes everybody under their wing for the first part of the series. Kyoko is the redhead. Kyoko's the...
She's the jaded.
Yeah, she's jaded. She's selfish and impulsive. But again, a lot more complicated than that. I actually really like Kyoko. And then there's Homura, the brunette. She's the best girl. when you're first introduced to Homura, she's very much cool and detached, and
she's Sasuke.
No, because
she's start off with
She's much more intimidating than Sasuke. Sasuke is bloody douche-nop. Homura's... There's something going on. She knows something's going on. She's not telling you, but she's telling you what you shouldn't do.
She's like, you think she should be their friends, but she's standing apart because she's too cool to be their friends.
Yes.
She's no intention of being their friends because they're beneath her. She's Sasuke.
She's not Sasuke, and I will... She's more interesting than Sasuke for by far.
Yeah.
Sasuke never evolves beyond douche nozzle.
No.
But, and number six, Kube.
Evil fucking rat bastard.
Kube is your typical, if you've ever seen a magical girl show, think Sailor Moon and whatnot. He's the animal mascot. He's this adorable little bunny cat thing with rings around his ears. And he pretty much grants the girls their powers and explains the situation to them without ever telling a falsehood. Everything Kube says is a lie.
Everything Kube says is factually correct.
Kube
is very much how I imagine dealing with a demon or a fairy would be. None of his shit comes to the surface till much later in the show. He's pushy about making the contract to become a magical girl. That's at first his only real flaw.
He's like a really friendly salesman.
Yeah. That's part of the thing, is to become a magical girl, he grants you a wish. Any wish you desire, whatever you might want. But in exchange, you gain superpowers, and you fight monsters that you, if you could fight before, you probably would anyway, because that'd be the right thing to do. So what's the downside? Clearly there's no downside here. Always read the fine print.
Yeah, the first alarm bell for me, actually, with Kube was the fact that he termed it as a contract, and that's never a good sign. Wish and contract.
It's totally Faust, is what it is.
He tries playing it off. It's more of a case of, you'll have to do this and be a magical girl and fight evil forever.
Right.
You know, for the rest of you. And it's a permanent thing, but you get this awesome wish beforehand.
The entire show is... largely revolves around Kube trying to get Madoka to become a magical girl and Homura trying to stop it.
Yeah.
And that's the central conflict.
They keep coming out, Kube and those in the know keep coming out saying that Madoka has the most potential of any girl they've ever met. So she could be an extremely powerful magical girl. And Homura just keeps trying to stop it, or trying to dissuade her. To the point where we meet her because she's chasing Kube, trying to kill it.
Yeah. We find out later this is a futile prospect.
Yeah. But I kind of twigged on to Kube quite early. I know you actually commented, Eric, that, you know, me and Peter were kind of twigging on a lot earlier than some people had.
Yes.
That had watched this. I mean, the first time he put the proposition to Madoka, I was like, this is some deal with the devil bullshit, isn't it? to which you responded, saying nothing.
The downside to becoming a magical girl, there are a bunch. But basically what Kube does is he rips out your soul and sticks it in a rock without ever telling you this is what he's done. Because you don't notice it, because you can't sense your soul.
Yeah, so if you notice on the image that we're using, I think, three of them have it blatantly obvious, the jewels on them. So Madoka's and, I forget the redhead girl's name. I'm terrible with names.
Kyoko.
Kyoko.
Yeah, Kyoko's in
Kyoko
chest.
Have it there on their chest, and the brunette.
Homura has it on her hand.
Homura can't see
Sayaka's, but it's in her belly button, and Mamu's got it in her... has it as like a hairpiece.
Yeah. Soul gem.
Yeah, it's a soul gem. It's what allows them to do magic and have superpowers and all this other stuff, because they're basically just driving around hardware now from an external hard drive. And the problem is every time you use magic, you sully your soul gemstone. So you fight witches. Witches are these big abstract monsters that influence other people into doing bad things, killing themselves, killing other people, causing disasters through negligence, that kind of thing. They're basically out there to cause misery and despair because it's what they feed on. And normal people can't interact with witches partially because they create sort of pocket dimensions called labyrinths for themselves. And the magical girls go into these labyrinths and fight the witches, which are surreal and abstract and beautifully animated, often using entirely different styles of methods of animation than the rest of the show. Like, there's one that's done entirely via stop-motion scrapbooking. This is what attracted me to the show initially, was it's not always successful with its animation, but it's always experimental and willing to reach out and try.
It is also one of the main reasons why people don't stick with the show, because I'll admit, the first couple of episodes when the witches were appearing, the switch in the art style was very...
It can be jarring.
Jarring, yeah. The blonde Mamoru?
Mami, yeah.
Mami. Until she got involved and actually started interacting back. She didn't have to fucking interact. Until she had they bring that like focus point, something to anchor yourself in that world. The abstract worlds were just very all over the place, and it was kind of off-putting. I'll say that.
Okay, that's funny, because that was the opposite reaction I had. It was I watched the show more. Because honestly, the first two episodes are very much your standard magical girl fare, which I generally don't enjoy.
See, I'm like that with comics, for example. If there's too much on the page and I'm struggling to figure out what's going where, I kind of drone out.
And I totally understand. I totally get that. Done poorly, it is entirely off-putting.
Yeah.
But the girls go and they fight the witches, and doing so causes them to sell their gems. But if you kill a witch, it usually drops something referred to as a grief seed, which can be used to purify the gem and allow it to use magic more efficiently again.
Yeah.
Where do I go from here?
I want to say at the beginning, for the first few episodes, it's really focusing on Sayaka and Madoka tagging along with Mami as she hunts witches, so they can see what the deal is.
Because Mami wants them to go in with their eyes open as to what's going on. She wants them to become magical girls because she could use the help, but she very much wants them to go in with their eyes open. So she's making sure she knows everything that she does, which is not a lot, it turns out. And it's very... The first two episodes are very much about setting up the audience's expectations. It's about, like, go off and have fun adventures in weird worlds and fight monsters and save people. It's very much how it builds things up. It's very much how it sets everything up. And then episode three happens, and consequences are introduced.
Yes.
Initially... Homer and Mami don't get along, because Mami clearly wants help with fighting witches, and she's a fundamentally lonely person. She's very lonely, she doesn't have a family, she doesn't seem to have friends. But hey, magical girls helping out, that'd be awesome, because now we can go off and fight together and be like a team in an anime, it'd be great. But Homer clearly doesn't want Madoka or Sayaka to become magical girls, and therefore they don't get along. In episode three, so they find out an ancient witch in the hospital. So they run off and get Mami, and Sayaka and Kube go into the proto labyrinth to keep an eye on things. Madoka gets Mami, and they start trying to catch up with them to get to where the witch is going to be born. And Homura shows up near the labyrinth. He's like, I'm just here to help you take this out. I just don't want them involved any more than they already are. Mami says, fuck you, you're staying here and uses her magic to bind Madoka by the entrance. She can't get any further.
Omura by the entrance, not Madoka.
Yeah.
Omura,
yeah. Thank you. So they go in and they fight. They go in, the witch hatches, and Mammy does some tremendously beautifully animated fighting of the witch.
Oh, yeah. Each girl
and dancing around is just so gorgeous. Holy shit.
Yeah, one of the things is each girl has a signature weapon.
Yeah, and how they fight.
And how they fight. And Mammy's is musket rifles.
Yes.
But she summons them by the dozen.
Yeah.
And goes through a complex gun kata where she pulls a musket, fires, tosses musket. It's like out of the Matrix.
Yeah.
Until her grand super move, which is all of the muskets, biggest musket, boom.
which she does to the newly born witch, which is manifests as an adorable little stuffed animal. And ha, I'm done, and I've defeated the witch, and then the witch actually hatches. It's a giant clown worm, and it immediately bites Mammy's head off and devours her corpse.
Yeah.
Consequences.
Yeah, that was that's how episode 3 ends, and that's a big tonal shift, shall we say.
Yeah. Saves the day because the magic dissipates.
Yeah.
And basically runs circles around the clown worm. Simply by appearing to get be eaten, but showing up somewhere else. And then explosions happen. It's not explained how this happens. It's just awesome, and you're like, yeah, it's just what she does. That clearly those are her powers.
But yeah, I mean, at this point forward, it's basically been akin to Sailor Moon.
Yes.
Tonally. So it's all, you know, it's all, oh, it's going to be awesome. We've been chosen for this, and we can do this, and we can be friends forever, and all the rest of it. And then it's the image of Mommy's hanging corpse just from the neck down, hanging out of the mouth of this evil killer clown, which eventually just bites down, swallows the head, and goes to work eating the rest of the corpse.
Yes.
And the characters are just stood there with, like, mouths like...
Yeah, and everyone's...
And so are you! You're just like... what?
Except for Kube immediately goes, you know, you could make a contract to stop this.
Yeah. That's about the time I started calling him Rat Bastard. Fucking evil rat bastard.
Post this... This is where we enter into Sayaka's like 3 or 4 episode long arc. She's crushing hard on this kid in the hospital. He had some sort of accident and that leaves him incapable of using his right hand. The thing is, he used to be a violin prodigy. Like before this, he was master violinist. So and. It tears him up that he can't play, and she's there every day bringing him new CDs to various violinists going through great classical music to try to cheer him up. And eventually he just basically breaks down and snaps at her because it's just he's trying to be nice to her, but it's just reminding him of what he can't do anymore. And it's ripping him into pieces. So
yeah, it's like somebody loses a leg, and so she shows up every day and shows him how high she can jump.
Yeah, he loves music, so clearly the thing to do is to bring him music and new awesome rare prints that she's found in trawling the various CDs and music shops, because he's having a hard time and I want to cheer him up. This seems like the right thing to do. So after his little episode, she goes to Cuba and she uses her wish to heal him and becomes a magical girl. And she does that, and her introduction as a magical girl, she actually saves Madoka. This is actually important. So Madoka is wandering through town feeling shitty about Mammy being eaten and runs into one of her friends from school who's acting very strangely. So she tags along, what's going on? Oh, I'm going off on a wonderful trip. I'm going to finally transcend everything and achieve enlightenment. This sounds bad. So she tags along to a bunch of to a bunch of other people, and they've all got little marks that indicate that they've been influenced by a witch, and they start mixing up poison gas. And she does the smart thing. She charges in the middle of the crowd. She grabs the chemicals and throws them out the window. And they all turn on her. So she dives into a closet in this abandoned factory. As they pound on the door, and this just happens to be the entrance to the said witch's labyrinth. And some more gorgeous experimental animation happens. Because it's a witch's labyrinth, and then Sayaka shows up and saves the day in a kick-ass manner using swords instead of guns. And it's... Here's the thing, Sayaka has no regrets at first about what she's done. She's made her crush stupendously happy and given him the thing he cared most about back. And she gets to be a superhero to boot. What is the downside here? This is great. The thing is, she's warned initially to only use the wish for herself. Because, you know, unintended consequences. This is the theme of the show.
Yeah.
What I like about that episode is it shows Madoka's constantly talking down about how she's kind of useless and isn't very good about stuff, but it shows she's actually she's brave and she can make snap decisions when she needs to. She steps up. She does when it's necessary. She's actually pretty cool despite her shitty self-esteem. And then Kyoko shows up because Mammy's dead. Clearly, this new witch hunting territory has opened up. What do you mean there's a new magical girl already? What the fuck, Kube? You told me I should come here.
Yeah, she's introduced and she's pretty mercenary.
Yes,
she's come here literally because it's an easy hunting ground.
Yeah,
to the point where when she finds out about this new magical girl, the first instinct is confront her, maybe kill her, take over her territory.
Right, put her in her place, so to speak.
Yeah.
So. The central conflict between Sayaka and Kyoko is basically, Sayaka's a good person. She's trying to defeat every witch and every witch's familiar that gets loose to save as many people as possible, regardless of the toll it takes on her or a soul gem. Kyoko's like, you're doing it stupid. You need to let the damn witches get big enough to make sure they drop strong enough grief seeds so that you can keep going. That's how this works.
Yeah, she's only there just to get the grief seeds to keep her own soul gem clear. She's happy to let people die if it means the witch will be hatched.
Right, which means she gets to keep doing what she does. Kyoko's all about gratification. She's you never see her not eating unless she's fighting. And yeah. She's another one without a family, and she's pretty much the poster child for wishes gone wrong. And they have a big fight, Sayaka and Kyoko, which Homura intercedes because Kube is there going, you could stop this, but okay, if you just made a wish.
She's also got one of the most interesting weapons. It's like a whip spear.
Yes, she's got a spear, and it breaks into like a three-part staff. Only there are a whole lot more parts than three.
Yeah,
joined by chains, and it's pretty cool. And she uses it in really interesting and creative ways. The thing about Kyoko is she's very much all about self-gratification. Doesn't take a lot to make her happy. She needs a full belly and violence, and she's happy. That's all she really needs. And the violence is really just incidental to is really just a means to get other things. She just wants to hang out and eat and play games. That's all she wants to do. Violence happens to be a game she's good at. And like I said earlier, she's the poster child for wishes gone wrong, because she used her wish for her family, and now they're not around anymore. She was a preacher's daughter type of deal, except her dad had funny ideas about religion and wanted to basically create a new one to better suit modern times. So no one fucking listened to him. He became a street preacher. They were hungry all the time, because no one would hire the crazy street preacher. So she used her wish to make it so that people would listen to him, because he did have good ideas, she thought. And clearly they just needed to listen. So things become successful. She runs off fighting witches. Her dad's preaching the good word. They have plenty to eat again. Everything's going great until dad finds out what was going on. That it wasn't his ideas attracting the flock. It was the magic involved in her wish. So he loses it and murders himself and their family.
And so, more importantly, proceeds to, the other crux is that he immediately declares it witchcraft.
Yes, he declares it witchcraft. He accuses Kyoko of being a witch, which she finds sadly hilarious. She states as such. She says, and that's funny because I'm out there fighting witches every day, and he didn't even know. And yeah, she's got the tragic. She's has a very tragic backstory, and she's very much why you need to make sure that what you're using your wish for is for the right reasons. Using it for her dad to make people listen to his preaching was not the right thing to do. He wanted them to believe in his ideas on their own, not because they've been influenced by magic.
The problem with that being, though, is it sends... Go on. I am awful with names. You've said it a dozen times. I can't remember her name now.
Sayaka.
The problem with that is that conversation with them, sends her down her own little path.
Yeah,
she realizes she's used that wish to heal him, but realizes that he'd probably resent her if he found out that.
More importantly, she wasn't honest with herself.
And that too.
She wanted to heal him, but she wanted it. Deep down, she wanted him to be thankful for it, so that he would love her.
Yes.
And she wasn't honest with herself about that. And,
so because of that, she then basically just goes on this self-destructive
tear,
essentially.
There's the big. There's another fight between Kyoko and Sayaka, where the secret of the soul gems is part of the secret of the soul gems is revealed. They're going to have the fight. Sayaka's about to transform. Madoka grabs her soul gem and throws it off the bridge. Because you shouldn't fight. You shouldn't use magic that way. You guys are supposed to be friends. You're both magical girls. Haven't you ever seen Sailor Moon?
Yeah. She tries to get rid of the soul gem so that there's no magic. She's just a normal girl.
Right. Except the soul gem goes beyond, I think they state like 100 meters or so. It can no longer control the body. So it lands in the back of a truck. Because the bridge is over an overpass, and she immediately, Sayaka collapses after a few seconds because she can't control her body anymore. Yeah. And Kyubey reveals, why would you do that? Why would you throw your friend overboard? But Sayaka's right here. What happened to her? That's not Sayaka anymore. That's just her body. You threw her off the bridge. At which point, Homer returns with the gem, having seen what happens. Because she always sees what happens. She's the best. So
yeah, it basically just it gets revealed that the entire thing that Kyubey does is basically like you said earlier, he pulls out their soul, not just their soul, but their very essence, and jams it in this little gem. Because by his logic, that's tougher that way. The human body is weak and flimsy. And this way, your body can take a much bigger beating because it's not harming your soul, because your soul's in this little gem.
Right. And you can, and it makes it much easier to manipulate magic because you don't have all this meat in the way anymore.
Yeah.
And you can use your magic to heal your body and all this other stuff.
And you can deaden, and you can deaden pain because you're no longer directly hooked up to the nerves. And why is this a bad idea?
Yeah.
Well, you could have pulled
this. Cube is literally, there is no downside to this.
Well, you could have told us.
Damn well, you know, yeah. Damn well, there's a downside to this.
It's Cube. So anyway, the Sayaka's boy ends up, because she finds out she's effectively a zombie piloted by a rock on a ring, she can't bring herself to hang out with him anymore. So he ends up dating her best friend, not Madoka, the other part of the normal girlfriend.
The one they can't reveal the secret to.
Right. Because there's always one girl like that.
Yeah, and she starts thinking they're lesbian because...
And reacting very poorly to it, which is hilarious.
Yes.
Which, of course, just sends Sayaka into a depression spiral. She fights more witches and familiars. She becomes self-destructive. I don't feel pain anymore, so why should I care if I get hurt? I can just heal it afterwards.
It's also the point where you start to realize, oh, okay, so this soul gem, this thing that's getting tarnished and solid during these fights, that's not just a magical channel anymore. No, they're actually darkening their soul.
Yeah.
And then blocks start to fall into place.
Yeah, and... So after a particularly brutal fight that they see, Madoka's like, you shouldn't fight like that anymore. It's tearing you apart, not just physically. I'm watching the change in you.
She's also refusing the grief seeds as well.
Yeah, she's not picking up the grief seeds. Kyoko actually offers her a couple times because I can't... The reason she's... says she's doing it is because I can't keep watching you be stupid like this. But the real reason is she actually kind of likes Sayaka. She would like to be friends with her and doesn't want to see her tear herself apart. So Madoka has the talk. You're tearing yourself apart. You need to stop doing this. And Sayaka's like, fuck you, I just found out a way that I'm actually good at this. Why don't you make a contract? And runs off into the night, angry with herself for blowing up at her best friend, angry with herself because Madoka's right, and angry with herself because she's the one way she found that she was effective at fighting really is kind of terrible.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then you find out the next secret of the Soul Gems.
Yeah.
Yeah, one of those things that we kind of realized quite early, but it takes them a while to just...
They need to build up to it is the thing.
Yeah, well, the thing is that I liked is that, yeah, we all kind of knew where this was going, but they managed to steer it in such a way that it might not have been.
Right.
It turns out we were right, but you know,
there were ways that it could have gone, but they did go with the worst option for the characters involved. Basically, if you don't clean up your gem enough, or if you get too depressed and sorrowful, then the gem darkens. The more the gem darkens, the more depressed you become. The more depressed you become, the more the gem darkens. Eventually, it's a vicious cycle. And eventually the gem goes dark and it snaps and turns into a grief seed and a new witch is born. Magical girls are proto-witches.
Yep.
Yeah. And which is, at that point, then you realize QB really is a little rat bastard.
Yes, at which point Cube goes, yes, all is going according to plan.
Yeah. There's a really interesting scene with Sayaka on the train and these two assholes.
Yeah, they're totally just like, hey, man, you need to put that bitch in her place. And, you know, she's just some old hostess, and she ain't going to be pretty no more. What's she going to do without me? Blah, blah, blah. It's clearly the kind of talk of some pseudo-alpha.
You are not meant, yeah, you are not meant to like these characters. Yeah.
And Chiaka's listening to them go off about their girlfriends and how, yeah, I just smack that bitch whenever she talks up to me. Go make me a sandwich, grr.
Yeah.
Which is really, which, they're exactly what you're, what, they're despicable human beings.
Yes.
And Chiaka's like, why, but Tim, why would you talk that way about your girlfriend? She clearly loves you, otherwise she wouldn't be around such a terrible person. Why would you treat her that way? You're terrible. And then it cuts away as Sayaka's covered with scribbles.
Yeah. She has this one other line. It's, you know, what is it that I'm actually fighting to protect?
Yeah. And then Kyoka actually finds her in the train station afterwards. The two guys are nowhere to be seen. It's left up to you to imagine what happened.
Yeah.
And Kyoka's like, hey, you seem really down. Here, have an apple. Apples are good. Apples make me feel better, so they'll make you feel better. And Siaka's like, I'm an idiot. What did I think was going to happen? What is the point of fighting anymore? I was stupid. So stupid. And then she turns into a witch, and it's heartbreaking and terrifying, and Kyoko is there to witness it and goes, what the fuck? And pulls out Sayaka's body out of the labyrinth. And it, yeah.
Yeah.
And she explains,
there is one little piece that I liked is that we've then, it's at that point it's revealed that the witches themselves, all this abstractness that we've seen in bullshit, it's not random. It's actually a reflection of the personality that's gone bad.
Yes.
A lot of the imagery that Sayaka's form uses is music based.
Yeah. It's all, a lot of Sayaka's witch form is, it's a big, it looks kind of like a big abstract conductor wearing like Victorian, like Queen Victoria's outfit.
Yeah.
Directing her familiars, which are all wooden dolls, if I remember correctly, as
something along those lines. Yeah.
Yeah. And everything's built like a concert hall with like sheet music everywhere. It's really kind of cool.
It really is.
You're literally seeing the hopes and dreams of these girls. And you realize that that's what you're seeing.
Yes. Just,
you know, their inner psyches being twisted and perverted.
Yeah, and the other thing I'd noticed earlier, and this sort of the reason I was sort of tweaking to what was going on, is that every single witch and, like, their labyrinth and their familiars, all this had these very sort of childlike, abstract sort of art style to them.
Yeah. Hence the, you know, the fluffy animal that turns into a clown.
Yeah,
right.
The first witch they encounter with the cotton balls and scissors.
Right.
Yeah.
And the one at the hospital that kills Mammy is all cakes and stuffed animals. And candy. Yeah. And Sayaka is all music and dolls.
Right.
So Kyubei has a talk with Madoka, because clearly she still needs to become a magical girl. So he needs to put a spin on this horrible development. You see, we're just trying to save the universe from the heat, from entropy. Every time you use energy, some of it is lost. The thing about human emotions, it's a bottomless supply of energy, and we can harness it through the transformation of a magical girl into a witch. The yield of such a transformation is exponentially greater than the energy used in its creation or invested in creating a magical girl. We can use this to save the universe. Don't you want to die to save the universe?
So basically, it turns out that Kyubei is not the devil. He's a fourth dimensional rat bastard.
Yes.
He's
alien.
He's an extraterrestrial. It's implied he's extra dimensional. and he's trying to stop the... He says he's trying to stop the heat death of the universe. And there's no reason to doubt him. He's told the truth and everything else. He's been factually correct in everything else.
Yes. And, you know...
Tell us, you didn't ask.
Yeah, right. And there's all this... Yeah, you know, he goes on mentioning about, you know, the fact that the couldn't do it with them, his own, their own species, because they don't have emotions.
Yeah.
Which explains a lot about him. And there's this really sort of brutally cold logic about it that's completely and utterly, yeah, that's... This is all actually, you know...
Well, he starts saying, you know, do you want cows? What you going to do to them?
Yeah, we trust it much better. You're given a choice in the situation. You're given an otherwise impossible wish that is simply isn't possible without this transformation. You, what we're giving you is worth a lot more than we're asking you to give up.
Yeah, it's just your life.
And you know, and. There's again, it's this. There's this cold math about it that's entirely. Yeah. It sort of almost plays in that sort of the classic Vulcan. You know, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few, and it's technically correct as everything Cubae says is.
And the one lie that Cubae gets caught in, that I believe is his only lie, is he repeatedly says he doesn't understand human emotions.
Right.
But the manner in which he manipulates and drives people and plays up their fears and insecurities tells me he doesn't understand how they work, but he certainly knows how to manipulate them.
Yeah.
Because Cubae is possibly the most evil character in all of anime.
He's high on the list.
Yeah, it's like, oh, your best friend just got eaten. You know, you could do that.
Yeah, you could... You should become a magical girl to stop this witch, because otherwise she's going to kill you, and I'd hate to see the loss of all that potential energy.
See, if you were a magical girl already, you could stop that.
Yeah. So, this is where Kyoko finishes her turn to protagonist, for all intents and purposes.
Yeah.
Where she goes, well... I have her body. Can we turn her back from being a witch? Can we reverse the process? She goes to Cubae, who's the only person knowledgeable about these things. And he's like, well, it's never been done. And it's... There's no precedent for it, but can it be done? Well, everything about magical girls defies what we know about the universe, defies logic. So if it's possible, it's through you guys.
This is still a massive fucking lie.
Yes.
This is him saying, well, it's not been done before. If anyone could, it's you.
Now, this is him saying, it is just as likely as a sun going nova by the time I finish this sentence.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's, you know, nothing's technically impossible, so... Ah.
Yeah. It's like, you know, this is, you know, monkeys writing Shakespeare. So
yeah.
It's like, it could happen. Mm.
An important note that I missed is that Kyoko and Homura have been planning on fighting a massive witch, which is, Homura says, is supposed to appear soon, which cannot be defeated by any individual magical girl, and is so powerful it doesn't even need a labyrinth. It just pulls reality into its own labyrinth.
Yeah.
So, clearly, so Kyoko and Homura have been discussing how the two of them can defeat it and split the spoils. So Cubae comes up, when Kyoko goes up to Cubae and goes, okay, can this be done? Cubae goes, I don't know, nothing's impossible. She goes, aha, so it is possible. Theoretically. So she goes and recruits Madoka because into saving Sayaka. And her logic is, tells you everything you need to know about Kyoko, because she's like, you know, I used to love stories about truth and justice conquering all, and friendship being the only thing you really need. Those are great stories. I'd have forgotten how much I love those stories. Sayaka reminded me that how much I love those stories. I think since you're her best friend, you might be able to talk her down and return her to her Soul Gem. Let's go and see if that happens. What's the worst that can happen?
Oh, a lot of things.
Yeah.
So, turns out, Siraka was not a terribly good magical girl, but she's a badass fucking witch.
Yeah.
As Madoka sits there trying to talk her down, trying to remind her of who she was, while Kyoko fends off familiars and Saka's myriad of awesome kick-ass attacks, including throwing giant wheels and musical notes at them and swinging a giant paper cutout sword at them. And Homura shows up, because she always shows up. Because she's been watching. And so it basically becomes clear that Homura shows up and goes, "What the hell are you guys doing? We're trying to save Sayaka." "That's impossible. She's a witch now. You can't turn back from that. How do you know?" "I know." So Kyoko at this point has had the shit knocked out of her. And Madoka can't fight and is in danger of being killed. So Kyoko's like, "Get Madoka out of here." "Well, what about you?" "Well, you can't fight and protect her at the same time. Get her out. I'll take care of things." And then Kyoko self-destructs and takes out the witch Sayaka.
She kind of resolves that if that's the fate of magical girls, just to become witches, then she basically decides, fuck that noise.
Yeah, she basically goes, "Well, Sayaka's the closest thing she's had to a friend in a long time, and letting her die in pain by herself is not acceptable, and I don't want this fate for myself. So clearly the best thing to do is to self-destruct and take us both out." And she does. And now Homura, it's just Homura to fight while Purgus Knocked, the name of the aforementioned super witch. And Madoka, want to make a contract, Madoka?
Yeah, fucking relentless. I've worked in sales. I've known fucking rat bastards like him.
And that was Kyubei's plan. Get Kyoko killed trying to save Sayaka so that Homura can't defeat while Purgus Knocked, and the only option is Madoka. Because she will become a witch, she will become the most powerful magical girl, and then a stupendously powerful witch, and we'll have all this fucking energy.
Yeah. See, that's the thing, yeah. This is the thing. The way Kyubi's been been letting on is like, "Oh, you'll be a really powerful magical girl. You've got so much potential." And then you realize his plan.
Right.
But yeah, you'll be a really powerful witch.
And the energy released during your transformation will be stupendous. It will be unprecedented. We'll never see its like again. We must have you.
Yeah, and considering this super witch is supposed to be the big bad right now, and she's possibly more powerful than that, she's like extinction level threat against actual humanity.
Right.
And QB's like, "That'd be awesome."
Which brings us to Homura, which is where her story starts. Her story is entirely in flashback, because Homura is a time traveler.
Yeah, the weapon that you see on her arm there, the shield.
The shield.
It's a time
spinner. It's actually a clock.
Yeah.
And you see every interaction between Madoka and Homura. Homura's her cool self, and then Madoka says something, and she almost loses it and breaks down. In fact, she does a couple times.
Because when we're first introduced really to Homura, and she shows up at school, and you kind of get the impression that something's going on, but you just think she's just super cool, super skilled, because she's stood at the front of the class, she's the exchange student like they always do in Japanese high school or middle school, whatever.
They love their tropes, and they love playing with their tropes in the show.
She drops, the teacher's like talking and while writing on the board, and then she drops her chalk, and Homura, without even flinching, like grabs it. She's super confident in front of the class. She writes her name completely perfectly, and she
knows all the answers to everything, despite being out of school for medical reasons.
Yeah.
months.
She's the
best in gym. And the first time there's a real conversation between Madoka and Homura, Homura says, "Do you love this life? Yeah. Do you love your family and friends? Yeah. Would you give them up for anything? No. Then don't take anything that would change that. Don't make any changes to that. Just keep being you. Don't listen to Bunny Cat. Bunny Cat's a dick."
Pretty much.
And Homer's story is told entirely in a flashback because she shows up the first day in class.
Yeah, it's like retell of episode one.
Except her hair is in braids and she's wearing glasses and she's not nearly as confident. She's a nervous wreck. She doesn't know any of the answers. She was, in fact, out of school for medical reasons, so she's been bedridden with a heart condition for months and just completely sucks in gym.
Yeah.
And Madoka's there. She's encouraging her. She's helping her out. And walking home one day from school, Glasses Homura stumbles into a witch's labyrinth. And she's going to be killed by scribbly familiars. And then Mammy and Magical Girl Madoka show up and save her. And Homura takes on a role similar to what Madoka has in this timeline, where she tags along and helps out. And then, well, Pergasnok, the super witch, shows up. And Mammy and Madoka die. They take it out. They take out Pergasnok, but they die in the process. And Kube's like, "So, this sucks, huh?" Homura's like, "Yeah, this really sucks. My best and only friend just died. You can change that, you know. What? You can make a contract with me?" "Yeah, okay, sure. I wish to go back in time, redo my first meeting with Madoka, and have the power to save her. Done." Because I don't think Kube actually, once the wish is made, once he offers the contract, if they make the wish, I don't think he has any control over whether or not.
He doesn't, no. Hence the ending without jumping ahead, but yeah.
So she makes that wish, and she jumps back in time. Yeah. And
Which also explains as well, because although Kube has knowledge of all the magical girls,
he's got no clue what the deal with Homura is.
Yeah, when we first meet Homura, he's like, "I don't know you. I've created all these magical girls. You're a magical girl. I don't know you. What the fuck?
You're some kind of weird anomaly. How interesting." Yeah.
There's some weird anomaly that keeps trying to kill me.
What Homura doing is time stop. She's just stopping time, moving on.
Yeah. Yep. Hence the bit with the first witch where we see her like just in the mouth, then not in the mouth, then boom.
Yes.
Yeah, because she has another trick with that little watch as well. She has a time pocket.
Yeah, she can bend time, and in doing so, can bend space. So she stores explosives in her inside that shoe.
It's actually interesting because she like starts trying to fight early on, and she's sickly.
She's using a golf club,
and she's just not good at it. And like she's like, "Okay, how on earth can I actually get to fight? What can I do to help my friends? Because I'm physically incompetent."
Yes.
And she stumbles on the idea of the explosives. You know, stop time, plant bomb.
Looking up on Google, how to make pipe bombs.
Right.
And this timeline, she figures out, "I can make bombs. That's how I'll use my time-stopping magic to help Madoka and Magica. Madoka and Mammy.
Yeah.
And we'll stop Wahlberg's lock together, and it'll be great."
Yes.
Yeah. And eventually that just evolves and evolves and evolves and becomes anything that goes boom.
Yes. Except this time around, who was it that witched out first? This time around, Sayaka witches out.
Yeah.
And so Mammy's reaction is to murder all the magical girls because they become witches, so we must immediately murder all the magical girls.
Yeah, Mami goes a little bit nuts because she it's revealed that Kyubey was lying to her just as much as everyone else. She had no idea that this was, you know.
Yeah, Mami's wish is to not die in the car accident Kyubey found her in.
Yeah, she was trying to recruit magical girls because she wanted help fighting the witches. Kyubey right. was like, yeah, sure, that's a good idea. That's a good
that's
reason.
That's an awesome idea.
Yeah. But once she finds out,
girls.
Once she finds out the whole thing about the witches, then yeah, she turns around. Okay, well, I'm here to stop witches.
She's gonna die.
Stab, 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 stab.
So she, so in the scene, she immediately takes out Kyoko, the most competent of them, turns on Homura, who's got time stopping, and Madoka takes her out before she can take out Homura. It's actually very tactical. It's like, take out the DPS, take out the support, take out the weak link. And then they fight while Poker Snacked, and they manage to pull it off. And as they're lying there, having chewed up all their magic, their soul gems clouding further and further, Radica's like, okay, so you got any grief seeds? I don't have any. You have any grief seeds? Nah. All right, let's become monsters and destroy the world. Radica's like, I've got a better idea. She pulls out a grief seed and she clears up Cormora's gem. Go back in time and you can go back in time. Keep me from ever making this stupid mistake. And one more thing. Don't let me become a witch. So that's where Homura becomes hardened, because she kills her best friend to save her.
Yeah.
And then she spends endless cycles prepping and trying again, over and over again.
And then it's revealed that Madoka Magica subscribes to the multiverse theory of time travel.
Yeah, because Kyubey figures out that Homura's a time traveler. She's not a time traveler. She's not from this timeline. He's like, and that's why Madoka is so powerful. Because every time you go back in time, it's for her sake. And all that potential from the previous timeline gets dumped on this one girl. Because you keep on going back in time for her sake. And every time you do so, you increase her potential. She becomes more and more powerful. Oh, and Kube's, during one of these time jumps, you learn Kube's actual feelings on humanity. Where Madoka
is, it's one of the timelines where Madoka is like, Madoka's actually really powerful in this one.
Yes.
And takes out Wolfergus knocked.
With one shot.
Right. And
then immediately pops and becomes a witch. And
which is more powerful than the witches killed.
Watching Madoka's transformation, Kube's like, huh. She really was the most powerful entity on this planet. She's going to wipe out humanity in about, I'd say, 6 or 7 days. Well, whatever. We've got all the energy we need. Fuck humanity. We're done. Not our problem.
Right. And Homura's like, wait, what?
And Homura's like, uh-huh. That's good to know, Kyubey. You're not going to try to fight her? No, I've got better things to do. He's like, and in that timeline, that's when Kyubey gets it. Oh, fuck, you're a time pop.
It's a wonderful Kyubey sort of, oh, man. I should have seen that coming.
So Kyubey figures it out this time, and he figures out exactly how to push Homura's buttons. It's all your fault. You keep on turning back time for her, but every time you do so, you make the end result worse because she becomes more powerful. And you can't stop her from becoming a magical girl. I'll get to her eventually. You can't stop me. Even that time you turned me into Swiss cheese, I just grew a new body.
And ate the corpse.
Yes. In as creepy a fashion as possible.
Yeah.
You can't stop me. I'll get to her eventually. I'll figure something out that'll make her pop, make the contract. And every time, and you'll turn back time again, which will make her more powerful, which will make it worse for you in the end. No matter what you do, I win. No matter how many times you turn back time, I win. And yeah. And then, well, Pergasnog rolls around. It manifests as a supercell storm. So everyone goes to shelters, except for Homura. who it turns has looted the entirety of Japan's military might for the purposes of shooting the fuck out of this witch.
Yeah.
they do a great job where the magical girls, those that are aware of it, are seeing this huge fucking abstract creature, whereas the normies, real people, just see a massive tornado.
Yeah, and the witch is like this giant, like a scarecrow in like a pre-revolution French gown with gears on the in the bell of it, upside down with a giant grin on a mask. And yeah, it's suitably weird and abstract and kind of creepy.
Yeah.
And yeah, Homura's, because Homura's good at planning, she's got RPGs and mortars and heavy machine guns and ballistic missile launchers
and nuclear submarines and fucking landmines.
Yes.
She's done this fight so many times now that she knows where the witch is going to land from this particular attack. So this time around, there's a big fuck ton of landmines and C4. And I mean, a fuck ton.
I was not kidding when I said a studio of a stadium full of C4.
Yeah. It's like falling into a bowl full of death.
Yes. Except this doesn't work.
No.
Pergus knocked. Gets the shit knocked out of her, but she's still fighting, and she's still coming in, and she starts beating the crap out of Homura. And this is where Madoka shows up, with Kube.
Well, Madoka, the important note is that Madoka's watching all this going on, and she's realizing that it's not just, Homura.
Yeah.
It's a real threat to everybody that she cares about.
Yeah, it's a real threat to everybody that she cares about, and she does care about Homura, despite the fact that she comes across as kind of crazy half the time, because after you relive the same month God knows how many times, you kind of get a little crazy. I mean, just watch Groundhog Day, see what happens to Bill Murray.
Right. And Madoka just has made up her mind. It's like,
yeah. So she goes out into the storm. She finds Kube. Homura has been knocked into a building as a piece of rebar through her leg. And she's like, all right, time to reset. Oh, wait. If I reset, then this timeline's potential gets dumped on Madoka, which means it'll be even worse later on.
It's
everything I've done, all the suffering, all my planning has been for naught. I can't reset anymore or things get worse. But I can't stop it in this timeline. What do I do? And she starts, and she's for the first time ever, she's caught an indecision about what to do.
Right.
And she starts despairing. She starts losing it. And Madoka shows up, and she's like, don't worry, I've got this covered. And so, no, you don't. Don't you dare. Don't make the wish. So Madoka goes, okay, Kube, you ready for my wish? Yes.
The important bit is that this is the bit where Homura does reveal to Madoka what's been going on somewhat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, not that... And Madoka is not that surprised, I suspect. She kind of started putting two and two together.
Yep.
And she's like, you've been my best friend, even though I didn't even know it. It's time for me to do something for you. Kube, I wish... that there were no more witches, that they never existed, past, present, and future. I want to stop all magical girls from that I want to prevent all magical girls from undergoing that transformation. And Kube goes, wait a minute, no, that's rewriting the universe. Do you have any idea the potential consequences of what you're doing? Yup. Pop.
Fuck you, rat bastard.
Yeah, and that this is Madoka sacrificing herself because she's
becoming a magical girl.
And she's rewriting the universe, but in doing so, she ceases to be capable of existing on the universe that she's created.
Right.
She becomes a universal law as opposed to a person.
Right.
And will never have existed in this new universe. Except Homer will remember, because Homer remembers all. Homer knows all. Homer is awesome.
Homer is not really from this universe either, is the thing.
Right. And that's how they win. Everyone gets what they wanted, except for Homer and Cupid.
Madoka literally becomes an omniscient being.
Yeah. She becomes God. For all intents and purposes,
she was sort of the patron. She becomes sort of the patron saint of the magical girls. Honestly,
yes. In a polytheistic thing, her domain would be magical girls,
right? Because like she, it shows her like, you know, and it turns out like Kyubey's species dilemma about entropy still exists, and they still come with the magical girl thing, but it's different. They don't become witches when they wear out.
They simply cease to exist.
Yeah, they just fade away. And the other magical girls remember them, but basically no one else really remembers much about them. You know, they sort of cease to exist. And it's depressing and sad, but it's not quite as tragic.
Yeah. And despair and horror still manifest, except it does so as these sort of mindless wraiths now, which are much easier to deal
with. Yeah, like demon forms. But she goes...
What I like about this also is it's Madoka's idea about what magical girls should be, because now when you defeat a wraith, you get a whole bunch of little grief cubes instead of a single grief seed from a witch, which engenders teaming up as opposed to fuck you, I got mine.
Right.
Yeah.
Working together and being friends with other magical girls becomes a much better prospect than before, because there's actually incentive to say fuck you, I got mine, and not work with any magical girls before under the old system. Madoka basically makes Sailor Moon.
Yeah, she takes all the angst out of it, and
well, not all of it.
Well, you can't get rid of all the angst, but you can change its form so it's not nearly as bad, which is what she does.
Right.
And Madoka and Homura is the best girl, because Homura puts herself through the Sisyphean hell over and over and over again for the sake of her best friend. Possible love interest. Interpretations vary. and it's kind of tragically beautiful, and she saves Madoka but doesn't get what she wants. But she's okay with that, at least on the surface. There's a movie involved, and weird things get weird.
Because it's been so long since I remember she does the farewell tour.
Yeah.
Where she lets go on then.
Sayaka.
She lets Sayaka, you know, have one last. You know, she goes to a concert of the young man that she saved. And gives him an extra wish, so to speak. He goes from practicing alone in an empty theatre with just them watching, and all of a sudden he's in front of this audience of thousands that are just applauding him, and then they just kind of fade away.
Yeah, the implication to me at least seems that Madoka seems to basically show up when one of the magical girls fades away in this new universe, and
she takes them away to exist on her new plane of existence.
Right. And it sort of gives them gives them closure.
Yes.
I think sort of the implication.
And during the whole reconstruction, you see Madoka with each of the fallen magical girls at some point. When she comes to Sayaka, it's in the concert hall, and Madoka's like, so I could save you and make it so you never made the wish, but then no, this is the right thing to do. He gets to play his music. That's all I really wanted. Everything else just muddied everything else. I'm okay with this.
Yeah. I think the two that actually just straight up died, I think they just get resurrected, don't they?
Yes, they do.
Yeah.
Yes, that's what I was thinking.
Both Manny and Kyoko get resurrected because, well, they didn't flare out.
Yeah.
And that basically ends Madoka Magica.
Yeah, and...
Yeah.
There's a little bit where sort of, you know, with Homura talking with Kyubey and it's pretty clear she sort of explains, like, you know, way it used to work in Cuba. It's like, wow, if that was actually possible, that would be far more efficient in this system. It'd be much better.
And Homer's like, our relationship was not the best. Understatement here.
Don't give the little fucker ideas.
Well, Badoka's made it actually impossible, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah.
And for all the sorrow and misery that happens in the show, it ends on a profoundly, like, happy note. It's
confusing as all balls, but yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Like, through... The show's all about the consequences and despair of all of this, and it's undone by an act of compassionate self-sacrifice.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
And that's awesome.
I wouldn't call it a happy ending, though.
No.
Everywhere else it was going.
Oh, sure. It's not as bad. No, I agree completely. But
this
yeah.
This is a tragedy.
Yeah. No. That is sort of what we're sort of getting to our thoughts on the show, because I think it's about, I mean, we've talked about the characters and what's going on. This is honestly an honest to God Shakespearean tragedy.
Yes.
Like, down to the point where, you know, Homura is a tragic heroine. She, you know, she's a great person with this one tragic flaw, and she ultimately fails.
Yeah. She doesn't save Madoka. Madoka saves everyone else instead.
Right. And Madoka is, you know, Madoka's a big damn hero. I mean, there's no question about it. And Homura tries desperately to, you know, to save her and fails ultimately.
Yeah.
I mean, and it's spectacular.
Over and over again. But she keeps on trying, and that's why I love her.
But it's not even that it's not even just she fails over and over again. It's that she ultimately fails.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's, it's just, it's a perfect, it's, you know, it's Greek tragedy.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things I love about this show is the more you unpack it, the more layers there are, the better it hangs together. The more you pick at it, the more connections you see. It's honestly one of the most tightly plotted shows I have ever seen. There is not a second of wasted space in this show.
Everything
is important.
I would agree with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's about right.
It's one of the, I think I said, might have said at the end of the last episode, might have been after we stopped recording, but I think this might be the single best written anime I've seen. And by a not small margin either.
Yeah.
It is brilliantly written. I love the way, I agree with you, Eric, I love the way they experiment with the animation. And it's, I love the fact that they deconstruct the magical girl genre, but they actually did it with purpose.
Yeah, it wasn't just another 90s, let's give Superman guns, because why not?
Right. It's, you know, honestly, I'll put it this way. It's Watchmen, not Dark Knight. You know, it's not Dark Knight, you know.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, because it puts it back together at the end.
Right.
Because where in Dark Knight Returns, it... Batman's not a fascist with jackbooted thugs.
Yeah, it's like it's in the hands of a profoundly good writer, honestly.
Yes.
And I know I've seen some other stuff the author behind this has been behind. And all of it's good, and all of it has the same sort of sense of nihilism.
Yeah, but I still think this is his best work.
Oh, it's definitely his best work. It is a brilliant show.
And I adore all of the characters. They're all great.
Oh, they're
Kube. I love hating that little shit.
Oh, he's a fantastic villain, absolutely. And he's definitively a villain.
And the thing is
about him, he's one of the greatest types of villain. The guy that doesn't see himself as a villain.
Oh,
that's
no.
True. He sees himself as a hero. He's
yeah. We see him as a villain because we're looking from the, you know, we're looking from the cattle.
Right.
Right. I mean, again,
the slaughterhouse.
Right.
And he's like, well, hang on, I've, you know,
that doesn't make him any less evil.
No.
Because he actually goes after middle school girls because they're the most naive and they're the
they're the easiest to manipulate. They're
and. Too young, and they don't get angsty enough, too old, and they see through him. So clearly, these are the ones that we need to fuck with.
Yeah. Yeah, the most emotionally unstable as well. So you know the tumultuous. Sorry. So
all that you know, going through puberty and hormonal changes and all that stuff. Perfect fodder. God, you asshole.
Exactly. He's a monster.
I mean, the thing is, he's a sociopath. But by definition, his species are sociopaths.
Yeah. But like he'd say, that's our definition.
Well, yes. I mean, and as I said earlier, there's a real cold mathematical logic about what he's doing, and it makes perfect sense.
They're going for the. Yeah. It's like Q in Star Trek. You know, the entire universe is his ant farm.
No, because Q is actually trying to teach people lessons. Cube is just
after
rewards of fucking with people. He's not trying to teach any lessons. He's actively holding back information.
He's not holding you
to finding the answers. He's actively hiding them from you.
Like I said, he's the farmer in charge of the slaughterhouse, and we're the cattle.
Yeah.
Hence, we feel he's evil.
It's there's a lot of stuff that you can go. Oh my god.
I've seen people try to say Kube isn't evil, and I was like, no, Kube is evil.
That's like saying Light Yagami's not evil. Fuck you.
It's like saying Darth Vader wasn't evil. Darth Vader's a paladin. He's upholding. No, Darth Vader was complicit in the obliteration of billions of souls. He actively hunted down and murdered his friends. He's evil.
He murdered children!
Yes.
Fuck you! But yeah, no, my point is, honestly, I think this is one of the most interesting shows I've watched. I spent a lot of time during the show sort of trying to figure out what was going on, because it was presenting things in the way my brain works. I'm like, okay, there's a puzzle piece. Where does this go? And I started putting things together, and I occasionally would postulate questions to Eric, and Eric would do his damnedest not to answer them.
I'm not very good at being Kube.
No. But yeah, it's I have this sort of even today, like after several weeks after I finished watching, I'm still trying to decide whether I liked it. I think it's brilliant. I have zero regrets watching it. It was a wonderful experience having done so. I'm not sure I want to rewatch it though.
That's kind of my thing.
The show gets better with rewatching is you notice other threads that tie to other things, particularly the first couple episodes, which the first time you go through, you're sort of like, okay, let's get to the experimental animation again, and then you rewatch the show again. It's like, oh, this is all actually important.
Yeah, like, honestly.
For other things.
Yeah, honestly, I've been told that there's more to the show than what it looks like at first. And if I'd been watching this on my own and I hadn't been told that, I wouldn't have gotten past episode 2.
No.
I do not blame you. I would not blame you. The only thing that kept me going through episode 2 was the neat animation in the labyrinths.
But the fact that I had been told that there was something more to it than what it was on the surface, I was busy going, okay, there's more to this, there's more going on here than it seems at first. And I start noticing there's little sort of subtle things, like, as I mentioned, the whole thing mentioning it was a contract. I'm like, and there's a wish and a contract. That's never a good combo.
See, this is the thing. I mean, as obviously, not to try and sound big-headed or anything, but, you know, between the three of us, we're role-playing gamers, if not games masters, games crafters. Devourers of fiction.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, these sort of things we were twigging and thinking, you know, the antenna were twitching quite early.
Right.
It took me a while to pick up on things because I was expecting just another Magical Girl show with neat animation. And
I can imagine
Magical Girl shows. So I was just sort of.
I can imagine a lot of people overlook this.
Yeah.
You know, if say for example you've watched the trailer and you're thinking, it's Sailor Moon with a weird art style.
Yeah.
Interestingly, think about watching the trailers, and if you're someone who is a normal fan of Magical Girls, and you're like, you know...
Oh, good lord.
Because it was marketed that way.
Yes,
oh,
absolutely.
Good lord.
Intentionally.
In the closing.
I'll get to that. But, like, yeah, there's, like, if you look, like, They intentionally, like, the script they use for the title is intentionally cutesy and curved and attractive, and it's sort of, everything is done in this style to make you think this is a magic, this is a typical magical girl show aimed for, you know, aimed at, you know, sort of the, you know, the audience of, you know, girls of that, of the age of the characters in the show.
Yeah, it's totally playing with all those tropes and using them to draw in the usual audience.
Right, and then to try to make them think.
Yes.
Yeah. So there's like, there's a crowd of, there's now like a fucking group of, well, late teenage girls now that grew up with Sailor Moon are just traumatized after watching this.
Well, it's like Frozen with the, except, you know, with a considerably more tragedy and death.
Yeah.
Look, it's a princess story. You have to go and save the princesses. There's true love at first sight. Oh, he's an evil cockbag.
Yeah, that's the same. If you, a lot of people will probably overlook this because of how it looks, and then you get a lot of people that have got suckered into watching this.
Yeah, and it's
because of how it looks.
The art style is totally like Moe Ball. Like,
but it's all, yeah, it's pastels. Yeah.
I mean, look at the title card. It's a bunch of cute girls in pastel dresses hanging out.
Yep.
But
I think I'm with Peter on this one. It's one that I enjoyed watching it. Not sure I'll watch it again.
I'm going to watch it again.
I'm not surprised. Yeah. And I very well might watch it again at some point, but
I had seen it several times before I inflicted it upon you guys. I'll watch it several more times.
Just for completion, I may watch the movies, or a couple of them.
Yeah. Before we talk about that, I want to say, Eric did bring a point about the opening and closing.
Yes.
The opening theme, which it is everything every sort of classic magical girl anime is, and as Eric put it while we're watching it, it is literally everything Kyubey is selling the girls.
Yes.
Yes.
Just throwing around in cute outfits, having adventures with your friends, and yeah, there'll be some tears and heartache along the way. That's all part of the adventure. And the music's all upbeat and fun.
And then there's the closing theme, the actual closing theme, which doesn't show up until after the third episode.
Yeah. Until after Mammy gets her head bitten off.
Right. Which is dark and
strange, and the animation for it is just this multicolored silhouette of Madoka running through a swirling void, seeing the silhouettes of the other girls like falling down by the wayside as she runs past them, constantly running until she ends up in the fetal position in the eye of this giant, like, very painterly done face.
Yeah.
And this Magia, the ending theme is honestly one of the best songs to come out of Japan in ages.
I also liked, I mean, I made a comment quite early as well, and again, I got the I'm not saying anything response, where it was must have been like episode, I think it was about 3, maybe 4, with Kyubey going on and on and on and on at Madoka to try and make the contract, and I'm thinking, and I said, This show's gonna prick teasers, isn't it? She's not actually ever gonna become a magical girl, is she?
She does.
Eventually.
Very briefly.
Yeah.
Actually, arguably, she becomes magical girl a whole bunch of times in the show.
Yeah, yeah. In the multiverse.
But yeah, again, if you haven't watched this, even with all of this that we've, if you've listened to the show and haven't watched this, watch it anyways.
Yeah, it's definitely worth a watch at the very least, because it's so much, it's so different. I've shown this to friends and they've given me the look, you know, they're like, the fuck are you talking about?
There are several friends that have gone, you need to see this show, and they get to the second episode and go, Eric, what the fuck, I'm not watching.
No, I don't even mean the second episode. I've
two more episodes. Oh, trust me. Fuck you, Eric.
I've shown them the picture, and they're like, "Fuck off! I'm not watching that."
It's like, no, seriously, you have to watch this. It's not what it seems.
Yeah, I'm trying my best. Everything you guys are recommending, I'm trying to promote. I've got one of my friends, to watch One Punch Man. He doesn't like it because it's not rated serious.
But. Like,
He will not touch this.
So eventually, my friend Hannah eventually like sat down and watched this because we were talking anime at some party at some point, and I brought up Madoka Magica, and I went evangelizing for it. So she eventually sat down and watched it, and she was like, she finished it. She's like, "So Eric, I finally watched Madoka Magica. Oh, what'd you think?" And she's like, "Well, at first I was like, what the fuck is with this? I hate the main character. Her voice is so annoying. And then episode 3 happened. I was like, oh, now I understand why Eric likes this show."
Oh my god. So yeah, Madoka Magica is a show that is, I have to say, I think we all would say is definitively you should watch the show.
Yes.
Yeah. It is
everyone should watch the show, even if you don't like magical anime.
Yeah.
I'm not particularly fond of magical girl anime. Their explosions aren't big enough for me.
There aren't enough giant robots, I agree.
Not enough giant robots, and their beam attacks are usually quite poor. But this one, yeah. Just because it goes in that different direction.
I can get the appeal of magical girl shows, honestly. I get the appeal. They're not my personal taste, but I get the appeal.
I totally understand why people would enjoy them.
Yes.
It's
and
very bait and switch.
This one, yes.
Yeah.
The thing about this is, I love a good deconstruction when it's done well. And that's sort of my take on it is, like, I haven't reread Watchmen very often either, honestly. Despite the fact that I would say it's one of the, I've said many times, I think it's the most important comic book ever done.
I would agree with that.
I would say this might actually be the most important anime. At least in modern times.
It's a damn good show. It's beautifully written. Well, the animation isn't always good. It's always trying to be good and always willing to experiment.
And there are times it's spectacular.
There are times when it's absolutely spectacular. There are times it will make you weep with how good it is.
It's amazing.
There are times I'll go, well, I see what you're going for there.
I know what you're trying.
The first time we see, because like I say, I like traditional sort of style. The abstract was okay, but I needed that basing reality bit to get.
Yeah, the moment that Mommy starts fighting.
The first time we see Mommy fighting. And the style and the complexity of her fighting style.
Yeah, she's gorgeous. Definitely the flashiest fighter in the show. And
oh my
she's
god,
she's a joy to watch, just manifesting guns and shooting them in all directions.
It's spectacular.
Yeah,
I can't recommend this show highly enough, honestly. Even if I'm not sure I enjoyed it. I think I did. I it's one of the things I'm still thinking about it is the thing.
Yeah.
It's
like going to the cinema, you know, you can go and watch Star Wars, you can go and watch Deadpool, or you can go and watch Schindler's List. You know, you're not gonna enjoy it per se, or at least the content that's being presented to you, but you can still enjoy the way it's presented.
At least it's not, oh god, what's in that damn movie?
Requiem for a Dream.
That's it.
Yeah.
Best movie I never want to see again.
Yep. Oh my god. I was feel for a while during this, I was sort of feeling about it the way I feel about Tarantino's movies and Reservoir Dogs.
Yeah.
Reservoir Dogs is one of the most brilliantly made movies I've ever seen. I hate it. It's what I have so much respect for Tarantino.
I'm okay with that.
I have so much respect for Tarantino and what he did with that movie and with the actors and everything, and I didn't enjoy a second of it. Other than, like, the only enjoyment I got was admiring the craft of the movie.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's kind of what I meant. You can still admire the craft and the art, even if you don't enjoy the art.
Right. And this, I enjoyed this more than I enjoyed Reservoir Dogs. I'll say that definitively. But you know, I
adore this show. I'm going to watch it again at some point.
I'd be shocked if I don't eventually rewatch it, but it won't be for a while.
Right.
I will, if nothing else, it will at least, this one will give me an open mind in regards to watching other shows that I would initially, if I'd have seen this, I'll admit, will probably have just dismissed it.
Yeah.
Offhand. You know, this will at least open my eyes a little bit to give opportunities to other things.
Right.
And yeah, it's, I've watched several Magical Girl series after having seen this. And I still don't like them. Like, this or being more familiar with the tropes it's playing with.
Yep. So I think that's going to do it for this episode. It's a short series, so we weren't going to go on nearly as long as we do with the longer shows.
No, yeah.
We've gone on for almost 2 hours again.
Not quite that long. But yeah, only about an hour and a half, really. So, anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed this. Again, if you haven't watched Madoka Magica, go watch it, please.
It's great. I adore this show. Do it. Do it. Do it now. Do it.
Next week, we're going to be covering... Next time, maybe next week, I don't know when we'll do it, but we'll be covering Gav's next recommendation, which was Gundam Build Fighters Try.
Yes.
So, a complete tonal shift.
To be fair, after this one, we needed it.
Yes. Can only take so much.
We should have watched Grave of Fireflies next.
Screw no, that's what I'm not watching again, Eric.
No, I'm not again either. That's the second best movie that I never want to see again.
Yeah. Oh. Anyways, guys, for me, Eric, and Gav, say goodbye, guys.
Bye, guys.
Take care, everybody. We'll see you guys next time.
Latest.